The Ark of the Covenant is mentioned 10 times just in the third chapter of Joshua. 10 times. That's how serious the presence of God, the chest of God, the Ark of the Covenant was to God's people. So here's the principle that we have to live by our entire life. Follow after God. Look for His activity. Ask Him to heighten your awareness of His presence around you. You have, just like you have 5 physical senses, you have spiritual senses. Ask Him to cause your spiritual sensitivity to be heightened, your spiritual eyes to be open to see His activity, your spiritual ears to be sensitive to hear His voice around you. Ask the Lord to make you aware of His activity and His presence, so that when you see Him moving, you can move in His direction, even when it derails you from the direction you were currently on. We've got to be sensitive to where God is going and then follow hard after Him. This is exactly what Jesus did. One of my favorite verses is John 5:19. He says, "I only do what I see the Father doing." Do you know how many good opportunities Jesus turned down? There were so many good things Jesus could have done that He never did, because He said, "Look, that sounds nice, but I only do what I see the Father doing." Every good thing, basically what Jesus was saying, every good thing isn't a God thing. It might be good, but that just doesn't mean that it's God. And Jesus said, "Listen, I'm just here for a short time. I want to finish this race well. I'm only going to do what my daddy is already up to." Do you know the notable thing about Jesus Christ while He was here on earth? What I love about Jesus' 3-year ministry on earth is that not only did He do the Father's will. I mean, it was nice that He did the Father's will. But here's the kicker. He not only did the Father's will, but He did the Father's will and nothing else. I mean, that's the huge thing that we sometimes can't grapple with. We're all about doing the Father's will. We just want to do everything else along the way of doing the Father's will. So this is what happens. We are so exhausted from doing the everything else, we never actually get around to fully doing what God asked us to do. We are wiped out, frustrated, stressed out, overworked, underappreciated, because we have done everything, all the good stuff, and then we've got leftover energy for the God stuff. Jesus said, I only do what I see the Father doing. I remember in the book of Mark, Jesus has had a full day in the temple teaching, healing, preaching, and then at the end of a long day, He goes to one of the disciples' homes, and there's someone there that needs to be healed, and so He heals that person, and it's evening, and it says that in the evening, there was a whole crowd of people that were standing around the door. It says the whole city was at the door. Have you ever felt like the whole city is at your door? Like the phone keeps ringing, then the fax machine goes off, and someone rings the doorbell. I mean, everybody needs you. There's time for the meeting, the school, the PTA. Everything is going on. Everybody was at Jesus' door. And while everybody is at the door, it says He crept out early in the morning and went to a solitary place to spend time with God. Why did He do that? Because He only does what the Father's doing. It means He's got to spend time with the Father to find out what He's doing, so His eyes can be open to see His daddy's activity. And so He peels off to the side. I mean, everybody's waiting on Him. He peels off to the side. He spends time with the Father. The disciples track Him down and say, "What are you doing? Do you know that everybody in the city is looking for you? There are some people that need to be healed. And God, there are a lot of people around. If you go heal them, this will be quite a show. Because everybody will now know who you are if you heal these people in a crowd, in a multitude this size. Jesus, let's go do our thing." And Jesus looks at them, having spent time with the Father. He looks at them and He says, "You know what? That's nice over there. That's good. But I've just spent time with God, and He's told me there's some preaching that needs to be done in Capernaum. So let's pack our bags and get to Capernaum right now." The disciples cannot believe it. "You telling me, Jesus, we're going to pass up all this good stuff?" And Jesus says, "Absolutely, because I've been on the lookout for God's presence." What good stuff do you and I need to pass up in order to determine that we're going to have to spend some time with God, aren't we? To find out where He is moving. I want you to notice that Joshua says, look for the priests who are supposed to be carrying the ark. The priests are the ones that are supposed to be carrying God's presence so that you have something to keep your eyes on. I want to just challenge you in regards to the church that you attend. I hope that there are some priests in that church who are carrying the Ark of the Covenant. I hope that it's not about your pastor and his opinion, but it's about him holding up the presence of God as revealed in scriptures. That what he does at your church, in your Bible study, in that organization in which you're involved, where supposedly they're supposed to be teaching you Christian principles, would you make sure that what they're doing at that church, in that Bible study, in that organization, is not sharing with you their ideas, their ideals, their opinions? What we're looking for are priests, leaders, who are holding up the presence of God before us, who don't want us to get to know them. What they want is for us to get to know God. Do you know the best definition of ministry I have ever read is in John, the book of John chapter 1. It says that John the Baptist is standing with two of his followers. He sees Jesus walking by and he says, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." That's ministry, when you just point out Jesus. And then the next verse says this. Are you ready for this? This is a good one. The next verse says, they heard John speak, "Behold the Lamb of God," and they left John to follow Jesus. That's ministry. Ministry is when your leader is holding up Jesus, holding up the Word of God, holding up the presence of God, pointing you to the activity of God. And when you hear that, you don't want more of the person who did the teaching. What you want is more of the God that they were just teaching you about. So Joshua says, here's what we're going to do. We're going to acknowledge God's presence. And finally, Joshua teaches us this new paradigm we're going to use as we follow God in this last week that we have together of our 6 weeks in the Promised Land living. You're not only going to act immediately. You're not only going to act fearlessly. You're not only going to acknowledge God's presence. You are going to anticipate God's miracles all around you. You're going to anticipate God's miracles all around you. Verse 5, Joshua says, "Consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." I love this. Joshua says, people, nothing has happened yet, but I want you to start acting right now like God has already done something. I want you to anticipate that God is going to do, the NIV translates wonders, amazing things. He says, I want you right now to consecrate yourself, set yourself apart, sanctify yourself, start living today like God has already performed the biggest miracle of your life. This takes faith, doesn't it? It takes faith today to start acting like your marriage is repaired. It takes faith today to start already praising God like that wayward child has come back home. It takes faith today to look at your doctor who has given you a very negative report and say, thank you for your medical advice, and I am definitely going to take it to heart. But I still believe that I serve the great physician who is always able to do more than I can ask or think, who can defy science. It takes faith to start consecrating ourselves, preparing ourselves for a miracle we have not yet seen. But Joshua turns to the people and he says, listen, we got a new paradigm of leadership if we're going over to the Promised Land. We're not just acting immediately. We're not going to just act fearlessly. We're not just going to acknowledge God's presence. But today, before God even shows himself, we're going to start acting like God is up to big things. Can I encourage you, sisters? Can I just kind of speak a word over your life right now, even as you watch this? Would you anticipate that God is up to something in your life? And I believe that he is. I believe that you're doing this Bible study right now because before the foundation of the world, he knew you would be sitting in this place, interested, stirred on the inside to experience more of God than you've ever experienced before. So I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to challenge you to start acting right now like God is up to big things. I think God responds to people who move in faith even when they don't see evidence that God is around them. That's what faith is. Faith is evidence of things that are not seen, things that we're just hoping for. Would you anticipate God's miracles all around you? To consecrate means to purify, to set yourself apart, to sanctify, to secure yourself only for God's usage. And so, with this new paradigm of leadership on their minds, the people make their final move to the Promised Land. The two from the original generation, Joshua and Caleb, the one in a million, and a whole new generation of people who had their minds set that they weren't going to wander like their parents did, but they were going to put one foot in front of the other. This is what happens when you and I make a decision to do this thing. I mean, you might be the only one in your family who's ever broken the barrier. You might be the only one you have ever known of your circle of friends that have actually started experiencing God and seeing His miracles and having faith that is beyond the faith you've ever seen in anybody you've ever known. You may be the only one, but what happens is when there's just one in a million, there's a whole crowd of people that are watching you. And all of a sudden, you stir in them a desire for more. I hope that over the course of this 6 weeks, I've been like a divine antagonist to you. I mean, I hope I have messed you up. I hope that you are just so unsettled, so dissatisfied with Christian life as you have known it, that you're going to not let the end of this 6 weeks be the end of your journey, but just the beginning, because now you want everything that God has to offer you and more. And so here's what happened. The priest carrying the Ark of the Covenant took a step in. And the scriptures tell us further down in Joshua chapter 3 that the waters, it was still raging. It was still roaring. It seemed like it was impossible and impassable. They had to trust that even though they could not see the move of God, that if God said it, something was happening, even in the places they were not able to physically see. Can I just tell you right now that if you will, with me, take a step into the water of impossibility that is in your life right now, you can believe that our God, somewhere where you cannot see in the spiritual realm, is already working out your miracle. Listen, you might not be able to see it right now, but God is up to something bigger than you can even imagine. It might be upstream. You might have to wait for the runoff to pass by. But if you will just wait on the Lord, He will renew your strength. You will mount up with wings as eagles. You will run. You will not be weary, and you will walk, and you will not faint. And I believe that together, as we take this journey, we will see the miracles of God. And all God's people said,
amen,
amen and amen.